one, she did her first Indian English film, which is Debashree, which seemed, you know, way ahead of its time at that time. And my grandfather, Jilanthadas Gupta, was a film historian and film critic. And he together, along with Satyajit Ray and someone else, founded the Calcutta Film Society. So growing up, I think what happened is I didn't grow up on a diet of Hindi films. Mm-hmm. I actually didn't watch too many Bollywood films. My mother was very particular about what I watched. She wasn't very particular about many things, but she was particular about what I watched. And you know, after a point, she was just like, you can't go legally doing this, you have to be doing other things. Even in terms of what I watched, she was very particular because she didn't let me watch a lot of the Hindi mainstream kind of films growing up. And in the 80s, you know, they weren't that great. Of course, there were a few exceptions, but it's not like that generally Hindi films were of a very high standard. And there was, of course, a parallel cinema movement, and there were films like Arthana and Satya and others, some of which I've watched. But she didn't let me watch, for example, the Mahabharata or the Ramayana when it came on TV. Because those, and these are epic poems, ancient poems. You know, which started with the oral tradition of storytelling and have just survived, and there are many, many versions of it across Asia, etc. But she didn't allow me to watch the one which was on TV because it was, you know, it was kind of low budget and a little tacky at the time. She didn't want my first impression of these epics to be what was on television, and she would rather that I use my own imagination. So in that sense, she was, I think she molded you know, my exposure, my taste, and that kind of shaped who I am, and I haven't grown up on a diet. But you know, like for example, in my film, there are sometimes people will say that, oh, it reminds us of Amitabh Bachchan as an angry young man. But it's, I've not seen too many films. Of course, I know the phenomenon, I've seen one or two, but it's not like I've grown up on that. That's just taken over my imagination in that sense. So I've had a slightly unconventional kind of a growing up years compared to my friends.
And I guess what you're saying is also that you've been at a distance from the way we've been thinking about Bombay and commercial film production in India, not just because of the distance of Calcutta, but also because of the very particular relationship that you and your closest family members have had with the commercial versus the art house.
That's true. Though there is commercial Bengali cinema as well, and there's a lot of that happening where it's called Tollywood, and they follow the conventions of mainstream films. So that exists, and one is aware of that also.
So clearly there's a certain, and I think that's something we want to keep thinking about over the conversation, that some ideas of what cinema is, what it ought to be, what it should look like, that happened in these early days. But I think we can segue right now into the start of your acting career.
How, my inglorious debut.
So what would you consider your cinematic debut?
So I think I was 3 or 4 when I did my first film. So having said all of this, my mother started her career with Satyajit Ray's Konkona, and did a few early films, and then went on to become a well-known mainstream Bengali film actress. And she was doing one of these films, which was by mainstream film, you know, I mean the very high pitch emotion, songs, you know, the big stars, those kind of films. And she was acting in one of these films, and you know, they were very popular. She was a very popular actress, and I would often dive along with her and go to various film sets and things like that. I've done that all my life, going to film sets, going to boys' parents, fought amongst themselves, took the boy home, and they were at a loss. So then they, you know, they just cut my hair and put me in the film. That's how I started my film career.
So maybe can we actually watch?
It is here.
So you were a boy, it was Indira, this one, if we can just make it, and can we turn this light off as well?
That's me.
Oh my God, I'm so happy to be here.
রুটি উপায় থেকে বার করেছি
শাশুড়ি শাশুড়ি
দাদা তুমি ছেলে কি মানুষ নি আগে ঠিক আছে জামাই
তুমি আমাকে গল্প বলবে না
তোরা শাশুড়ি জামাই গল্প না খা তুমি বাড়ি আসি আগে চল আজ না তোমাকে আমি একটা রাক্ষসে গল্প বলবো
না দাদাকে গল্প
চল বলবাই তোমাকে সব বলবো চল
So, how were you directed? How were you coached? It was very easy. They told me to say certain things. I said them. I didn't worry about it very much. I actually remember it very much. I just remember other people telling me then and after that, oh, you acted in a film and oh, you were good and all of that. And I said, oh, okay. And then I had to dub my lines, which is when you have to say back your own line. Which is difficult, you know, because at that time, especially they record the visuals, and later they need to watch the visuals and then speak your lines so they can record the sound. You all probably know this. So that's a little more tricky, but I did that as well. And mostly it's in sync. Some of it was not. And clearly they use dubbing also, not just for young children, but even later to also add extra context. There's a moment where your mouth is in movement, but you've got to dub a line.
They've got to dub a line. That's a very common thing. They do that all the time.
Yeah.
And I think especially with kids. Yeah, but most films at that time.
Yeah.
And even till today, some films, even my own film that can do that, sometimes if they have a small budget, then you have to work with the not live sound. And then you have to dub the whole film. It's a very tedious process.
So did you shoot Death in the Guns with sing sound?
No, I couldn't do live sound, which is really sad. In today's day and age, one should be able to record live sound. But the problem is that the house that we chose, the location, had a railway track right in front of it. So every 10 minutes there'd be a train passing, and then, it's passing at the wrong time, and you can't, Because when you're shooting a scene, you're shooting the master with everybody saying their thing, dialogues, and you're shooting a close, then again the train is passing at the wrong time, so you can't really control that and you couldn't.
So that's very interesting because earlier this morning we were talking a little bit about sound recording and how that really impacts the technologies of sound recording, the way films look, the content of films, and also impact of the city. So we were talking about how in the silent period, Bombay Film Studios used to be further south. But as development increased and cities got more congested and talkies started with very poor soundproofing facilities, studios were forced to move further north in more sparsely populated areas.
Right.
So you don't deal with the sound of train passing or a car honking.
Yeah.
So really, the studios keep moving further north to get away from.
And now most of our studios are really far actually.
Yeah.
Films started off with being seeing sound, I mean, silent of course, and then seeing sound.
Yeah.
When they would sing their own songs and things.
Yeah.
Then it went to dubbing. For a long time, we were dubbing our films, and then we got back to recording live sound and seeing sound now with most films. But what happens sometimes in small budget films is that you can't afford to wait on sound. Because it's all about time, because that's money. So, you can't say wait, you have to do another take for sound. I mean, nobody gets at that point, whatever you've got, you've got.
Does it impact, or do you have any preference in terms of how dubbing might affect your acting or you could alter your performance? Do you prefer?
I do actually. I said I'm old school, like I've been using an acting now for like 10 to 15 years, I don't know. But and if you count India, then many more years.
Yeah.
But I actually prefer dubbing because many people like live sound, and I think there are pros and cons to both. Because you get an authentic kind of experience. You get the quality of your voice changes with your body language and with movement and your breath. It changes so much. Sometimes you make your heartbeat if you want that. But I just and so people don't prefer doing dub sound nowadays to record it later as much. I like it. Because I find that, you can correct many things, you can fix many things, and in my film, when I'm dealing with an ensemble cast, and there's so many characters, and one person has said one tiny thing wrong off camera or something, and I know I can fix it later, it's much quicker, and it allows you to cheat more, in a way. It's helpful when you're doing a dialect, because I've had to do like a Tamil accent, or I've had to do an American accent, or I've had to do that Omkara Rupi dialect, which is all equally alien to me, and, so one has more time to perfect that accent, which I didn't get on Ankara.
Yeah.
So in that sense, live sound is...
So you're speaking now as both actor and director.
But the thing is that film making itself is so... I mean, everything data, we're going to edit it, we're going to color correct it. It's like putting a filter on every scene. So I just feel that, I mean, that's just an added thing, tool to play with.
And also for those, the students especially who might not know, even when you're recording sound and you're interested, you know you're going to dub everything later, there will often be a sound recordist who will record room tone or the general ambience.
Yes.
So that you can have some authentic sounds of the location to use along with that corrected, perfected dialogue.
That's right. Yeah, but you can't unfortunately do live sound. And I wanted to use room tone from the classic where we shot the film, but
yeah.
Couldn't because it didn't match.
Well, I noticed some students laugh when you said the word cheating. It's a very common word in film shooting. Do you want to tell us what it means to cheat?
Yeah, because it's such a convenient device and a great tool, because you know sometimes if you don't have the exact location that you want, probably you know this already, but when you don't have the exact location you want, you can just show somebody entering a particular door and then cheat that location in another place. So the camera is outside the door, it's another place, but when the camera is inside the door, you sort of match the door and the action of the door and the action of the character, and then you can show an entirely different space inside, and we do it all the time. And that's what I mean, like the cheating all the time, too, because we're all working with different tools, and kind of if you want to call it cheating or body artificial, because it's not a play, to create a certain effect. So I just feel that, you know, dubbing provides us yet another opportunity to do that.
And some creative kind of flexibility.
License,
right?
Flexibility,
So the other thing I was actually very interested in thinking about is, when one thinks about what your thoughts were, your impression about what is cinema, and given that you mentioned that you really enjoyed hanging out with your mother on her shoots, what were some of your early thoughts about what film meant? Did it mean filmmaking? Did it mean being on set? Did it mean having to travel or having to deal with my mother traveling? What, as a child, what did it mean? Were you watching a lot of films?
I think it was very different. I was watching a lot of films, but it's very different. So I had, of course, that one experience of just watching films, but also I then got to see like a behind-the-scenes version of everything. And the behind-the-scenes version of everything was a much grittier and a stressful place to be in, because my mother, see, when she was acting, I was very young. She gave up acting soon after. I think she already directed her first film. In the clip that we saw, which is again very different from the film she acted in, the film she directed. And so, growing up, my memories are of her directing films, more directing films. And since her films were not really the mainstream kind of films, they were a little different. So it was always a struggle for her to get funding for those kind of films. Because by and large how things work, at least from my end of things I understand, by and large how things work is, if you have a very popular actor or a big star to act in your film, then producers or the people funding the film feel reassured that the star power of that person can bring people to the cinemas. And so they will give you more money to make your films. You have larger budgets. But the films that my mom made, and many of the films that I've acted in, possibly even the film that I've directed, you know, they don't have big stars, and therefore the resources are very limited.
Yeah.
So I saw that end of things. My mom didn't have an office that she made films out of, so I was part of many production meetings, pre-production, and I believe I used to also make my own budgets on the side, like at least when I'm 5 or 6. So I used to do my own, I give you so much money, and some persons were happy to help me, you know, they were hiring me on the side. So I saw that aspect of it, and I think that's why I never wanted to be an actor or a director, and I never wanted to get into filmmaking at all.
So that's interesting, because after your Indira experience at age 3.5, clearly you didn't change your mind about this is what I want to do.
No, and I was watching all kinds of films. Also, because I was watching some Bengali films but also some other regional films, not too much, but also a lot of European films, lots of world cinema. But I think what was all pervasive and dominated our childhood everywhere for children growing up, I think in the 80s was sound of music. It was just, I mean, I don't know what it is, it's that generally just like that. I think that film and Mary Poppins, these were 2-3 films that one watched a lot of, and
have you watched it recently?
No, I don't want to watch it. I don't want to watch it anymore. But we watched all kinds of films. So, I got a sense that Bollywood wasn't it.
Yeah.
It was very clear that this is just one way of doing it.
Did you experiment with acting again when you joined college?
Yeah. First, so before I went to college, I did 2-3 other films. So when I was, I think, 9, I did a film with my mom's, and then I was 12, I did another film, so I did one of the as a family friend. So I did like little bit parts in Bengali films here and there. And all of it just reconfirmed the fact that I definitely don't want to act, and I definitely don't want to do directions, but not talk, but I definitely want to act. And also because everyone would always tell me, oh, you're such a good actress, so you should definitely act. So that, A, I didn't want to do what people were telling me to do. And I never really felt that I fit in. You know, in the kinds of films that were being made, I didn't see myself in them, I didn't look like them either. Which I don't know how conscious I was, like as I grew up, I think I was more conscious of it. So I never thought that that's my space. I never saw it as if this is where I belong or this is my space at all. Even when I joined college, I had done maybe one or two plays in school, but when I joined college, all of my first year, I was also very quiet and shy, growing up, especially. And when I joined college, I didn't even take part in any plays. I didn't want to audition in front of my seniors. I was very nervous and shy.
Because Stevens has the famous Shake Sock, like
yeah,
the Shakespeare Society.
Well-known drama
so
class,
yeah.
Which is called Shakespeare Society. And all my friends were participating, and I was very happy being backstage and, you know, helping out and things like that. And then in between, I think my second and my third year of college, I was offered a Bengali film called Akhiya Chikona.
There once was a girl. The English title is The Girl.
Yeah, there was. Which was a copy of a Hollywood film called The Crush, or Crush, with Alicia Silverstone, which was also terrible. It was a terrible film, and it was the remake was equally embarrassing and cringeworthy, and I think we should maybe show the clip and then talk about it.
Do you want to give us a little context? We're going to show a scene when you walk into a room with Sabri Sakshi and you try and act. So do you want to give us a little bit of plot context?
It's so long ago that I barely remember it. I just remember that the director had come to me with the script and I read it and I was, a bit of a snob. And I was just like, you know, a little appalled that I don't want to do this, this is not very good. But then my mom said, no, why did you hear him out? Because, you know, it feels like this film will have some kind of impact on people, or that you will be recognized in some way, or it has some potential to show your acting talent, whatever this, that, and the other, she said. So I was like, okay, I'll get out. And then everybody said this would be a good idea. And I could do it during the vacations between my second year and my third year. I kind of did it as a laugh, how some people may do an internship in the summer. I thought, okay, this summer I'll go and try this and see how it is. Never really thinking that it's ever going to release or that people are going to watch it or like it or anything.
But very briefly, it's about a young girl.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. It's about a young girl who's obsessed with an older man. And she's,
just to give you a context to get into the scene, it's a young girl, the age of a college-going girl that you were at the time.
18 or 19 in the film.
And she develops a crush on an older married man.
And so she's a negative character. She becomes really psychotic and eventually she tries to kill him. I mean, I hope you haven't seen the Hollywood version of it. Yes, and I'm showing you this, this is really embarrassing. This is, I'll tell you how I went through the process. You understand why.
And you might have to turn the lights off again. Thank you. Sounds like
you don't need the sign.
আমি তোমাকে তুমি করে বলবো ঠিক আছে মুখার্জি তোমাকে একটা করে চকলেট দিয়ে যায়? সে জমিয়ে রাখো কেন অঞ্জনদা?
So clearly you walked into this film very reluctantly. There was much hesitation, but you did it nonetheless. Did anything, how was the experience of actually shooting the film?
I was miserable. I was so miserable, I used to cry every day. I'm not even kidding, I used to cry every day. And I was like, I hope nobody I know will ever watch this film. And I was so embarrassed about the whole thing. I think I was embarrassed with the, I probably wasn't very comfortable with in my own skin. I was not comfortable with my own body to begin with. And then to see somebody behaving in this way that I was just so alien to me, and you know, that's how people will think that I'm actually like this and I'm not. I was very young myself. And I was mortified. I was just really mortified, and it's very brave of me to even show this kid, because I usually tell people not to watch the film. And then I went back to college and I forgot all about it, and we were doing, you know, theatre with sir and studying like that, and all feeling very cool. Nobody's going to know about that. And then it released and it did really, really, really well. Inexplicably, it did really well in the way that sometimes popular films do. And then we got some awards, some regional Bengali awards. I got a couple of awards, I think best negative role or something like that. Yeah. And but I remember, like, what I remember from the shoot was, you know, like the so much concentration on how I'm looking, you know, and I was not like that at all. And that made me so deeply uncomfortable. And I remember my mom used to say, before every shot, she used to say, TTFT. She and my acting coach would say TTFT. TTFT stands for tummy tuck feet together. And so before every shot, I was like, oh, and now I have to act. So I was just really miserable and uncomfortable during the entire film, and I definitely didn't want to continue with films.
Yeah.
I thought that this is what it's going to be like, then this is not my cup of tea, it's not going to happen at all.
And that's actually very interesting, because clearly, I mean, the role also leads to these anxieties. She's meant to be this young, seductive woman. And we all have certain kind of socially defined ideas of what the normative seductive woman or seductive girl have to be like, which can lead to several anxieties about it. And it's, I think, interesting for the students also to learn that acting requires a lot of moving out of your body and your own kinds of anxieties about who you are, what you think you look like.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that you mentioned
that. And you know, like for some other professions, you know, you have an instrument. Have like a useful instrument, or but I think when you're acting, your or you know, a mechanic will have his tools, but when you're acting, your body then belongs to your character. So, you know, hair, makeup, wardrobe, you're a character. So, even when you're resting in between shots, like many times, you know, you're just like, if you're resting in your van, you're just lying down like this, so it's not to ruin, you know, anything else, or you can't even just wipe your face because it's hot, which it often is. And you know, that's why I found it so liberating to be behind the camera in my film, Death in the Dutch, because I could be my own self, and I could, and you really, at the end of the day, have no control over how other people receive you, and what your image is, you know, like, I don't think you have to do your own thing, but people form their own conclusions, the media writes about you as, you know, they feel this fit, and sometimes, you know, you have to conform to that. You know, if you don't have to. I think I didn't, but when I'm acting in certain roles, I have to sometimes. And at that early age, I was not able to make my peace with it. I think it's something that I developed down the line. When I also started getting more roles, more interesting roles, I could choose things which appealed to me more, which were not maybe as commercial in sensibility as this one clearly is.
But also letting go of these anxieties about how much you can control, how you're perceived and how you're looked at, is also something we were discussing this morning, because we've been talking a lot about film journalism and how actors are talked about, and so much of the print, popular print industry in the city and in the country is dominated by writing about. So it's very difficult to be able to say, okay, so no matter what I do, there'll be groups of people that will say one thing and then groups that will say something else. So
absolutely. And sometimes I will even read an article about myself and like I've read about somebody else. I feel, oh, that's how I'm coming across, because it's just a little excerpt, and twisted. Very rarely you come across something which, you know, actually it feels like, oh, okay, they've kind of captured the essence of me, or at least in this film how I'm supposed to be. Many times it's like, you know, it's somebody else, and sometimes you have to behave. I think early on in my career, when I was not so comfortable with my body, I used to definitely feel that pressure of having to behave a certain way, having to, even till today, I actually don't like doing photo shoots because I don't like the way that I'm represented, I don't like the way I'm styled, I don't like the way I'm meant to look a certain way. I'm much more comfortable doing that on my own, and you know, if you see, like, and in a way, even though social media has, you know, caused another set of anxieties, etc., you know, I find that at least you're able to control your own interaction with other people, like, you know, if, how I want to look is how I can choose to put myself on Instagram, yeah. You know, as opposed to somebody else, this is how they want me to look, and that's, it doesn't work for me.
Which is again a very interesting thing for us to hear, because we've been talking a lot about how we are going to be trying to document our experiences of the city and media practices. And the question of ethics of representing other people has come up a lot, is something that these students are really very interested in. So it doesn't think about, we never think about the selfie as anything that could be possibly empowering, because there's so much negative writing about the culture of self-obsessed selfies. But clearly there is another way to think about it, given you have as a public person,
right?
So maybe let's think that, I mean, so the public perception that one cannot control is one aspect of it. But just to go back to Ajayatukuna for a little bit more, your own relation with the character as an actor who had misgivings about, I'm not like this girl, I don't believe in anything that she believes in. Were you able to get past that in order to complete the film?
Yes. I would have completed it anyway, but I think what happened is, I think towards the beginning of the film, or even because we did some readings, and my mother really helped me, who I resented her at the time. But she really helped me through the process, I realized today. There was a point when we were talking about the character, we were discussing something, or maybe it was with this movie, a rehearsal, and there was a point when I something she said, one of the dialogues, and I said, oh, no, poor thing. And I actually felt sorry for the character, because that's the first time I was actually able to relate to her and feel some empathy for her, which is so important when you're trying to portray, a person, another person. Because I truly think that we have all these things within us, you know. I feel like we have all these emotions within us, and we have to take out different things, and we do take out different things in different points. And sometimes a character will demand that you take out, you know, and you extract a certain part of yourself which maybe you want to touch with or is hidden deep down inside. But if that was a bit of a turning point for me, is the moment that and it's like a point of contact, is when I could actually feel sorry for her and realize that these are all the weapons in arsenal, and she doesn't really have anything else, to which we got this man.
And that's very interesting, because, I mean, that tool or that capacity to recognize that even this person that I think is very unpleasant, this character that I'm portraying, there is something there that I understand, the vulnerability. And as students and as teachers who read a lot of literature, access a lot of cultural forms, we do approach movies and literature as a way for us to develop empathy about characters and enter into worlds, right, that may be very far away from our own. But like even in Love by Chance, which is such a sharp critique of the film industry, the filmmakers do manage to balance things out, right, between cynicism and something else. So the film did really well, coming back to Ajayatukuna.
In a cinema, what I did.
Yeah, and you learned something and then decided to move on. How did the transition into full-scale acting, and when did that happen?
That was actually a few films later that I realized that, oh, I am doing this, it's going pretty well, let's stick to this because I don't know anything else. Because after Ajayatukuna released and it did well and things like that, I didn't think that I would go back to acting. Yeah. And then Rituparna Ghosh, who's a well-known Bengali filmmaker, offered me Tithli. And he was a family friend. So and he was also somebody who was making slightly different, what we call art house films or films in the independent space. So they were closer to me in terms of safer. It seemed like a safer space for me. And in that film, my mother was actually playing my mother. And, you know, my stepfather came along with us, and, you know, we brought to coach himself and my family friends. I knew many people in the troop because they've been in and out of my own house. So that was just the opposite experience of adventure program. We were not shooting in the city. We went off to north of West Bengal, which is a really beautiful, picturesque little town. And on a tea plantation, we were there for like a month. And, you know, it was a very, very relaxed and enjoyable experience. Again, I feel 19-year-old. In love with an older man, but made so differently. In love with chocolate, all
people. But I really enjoyed the film, and I really enjoyed being on that film.
Yeah, because in this film, I was more normal. I didn't behave like a psychotic teenager. It was such a relief to just, you know, just behave like a normal girl. So that, I think that positive experience eventually went a long way.
Yeah.
And then after that film, I decided that I finished college. That was just after I finished college. And then I enrolled myself in a master's program in Delhi University. I started that. It was a very disappointing kind of course. Coming from St. Stephen's College, which we had some good teachers. We had, students, who were on the same grade, like maybe some of them. And, we did plays. The building itself was very beautiful. The architecture of that place is lovely. And then I went to Delhi University, which was, probably like other colleges, just like regular colleges in India, where, the privilege to don't go. And and not just that, not just the ugliness of the building, but also they didn't teach very well. I was doing the same kind of things that I had done, in high school, at the undergrad level, and even now, we were again with Chaucer, Donne, and Milton, and Shakespeare, and all of that, and I found it very boring. We're reading a lot of poems in class. There's the difference between a civilian and a metaphor, and I thought that's it. We've only been doing this since class 7. So, meanwhile, I refused. Ritu Panagosh made another film called Shubha Moral, and I said, no, I'm doing my master's, I can't do another film, I don't want to do acting. So, I said no to that film, Namita's last lecture, I'll do that film beautifully. And then my mother said that I want you to do this film called Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, where I have to play a Tamilian woman. So, that Tamil Nadu is in the south of India, and they have a completely different culture, language, several different languages. I was playing this woman from Tamil Nadu, very removed from who I am, because I'm east of India. And I said, no, why would I do this film? You should take somebody who's actually from Tamil Nadu. And so my mom is very good at pressing my buttons, and she knows what to say and things like that. So she said, no, I want you to be my research assistant. Why don't you go to Chennai and find out everything for me in terms of, the Iyers are a particular group in the south, I think, generally. And, who follow, because the differences, very particular differences between the Iyers and the Iyengars, one follow a particular god, one follow another particular god, and then that dictates their cultural kind of norms and, religious and cultural practices and rituals and things like that, what they wear, how they speak, how will they even name their children and all of that. So I spent some time in the south and I was deeply, entrenched in that culture for a while and I really enjoyed myself. I loved it so much and I came back armed with a lot of information, this, that, the other. And before I knew it, I was talking like that and, my mom would say, yeah, you have to do this. And she would talk to me in this accent all the time, even when we did mundane things like eating or going out somewhere, we would just both talk in this very different accent. It's a funny accent, very different accent from our own. And then I said, yeah, okay, no, I'll do this. And then I went down to do Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, which again was a great experience for me because A, it was, of course, it was directed by my mother, who I was able to trust implicitly. It was a great film, it was a very well written script. There were good actors, we had very good money, but we were able to do it properly. We were, this is the first time that we actually had look tests in advance. We did, we worked on the costumes, we worked on the scenes together. I had to play a mother in this film, I wasn't a mother yet. I had to wear a sari all the time. I wear these heels and sari and have this child in bags. And so the whole body language and all of that changed. In fact, sometimes I say that it's very nice to approach a character from the outside in. Because those kind of, signifiers really help to kind of place you where you are. Because as soon as I wore that yellow sari and had that bag and the baby, I felt like this is like,
and it contains your movement, it dictates the way you're walking.
How you're moving, how you're talking, how you behave and carry yourself. very distracting. Children and animals in films, very distracting. Both in my own film, very difficult. And so Mrs. Iyer, with Rahul Bose and so many other fantastic actors who were in the film, we actually had a wonderful experience. That film did really well. It went to festivals all over. I won a national award for that film, and that, I think, changed the trajectory, because what happened is I got a lot of attention from the media and therefore from other filmmakers who are now aware that, you know, there's some person who's also acting. I got lots more offers. And I think after that film, I kind of just, even after Mr. and Mrs. Iyer released, I went back to Delhi to look for a real job.
Oh, yeah.
I was looking for a job. I thought that, you know, okay, I've got this.
What was your idea of a real job?
I was looking at the newspaper. I was looking at classifieds in the newspaper to see if you can speak English and, you know, communicative skills, whatever. So I thought, okay. And they didn't go very well. Either in the middle of the small process, I won the national award. So then I started getting other offers. And eventually, I think, starting from there, I kind of accepted that, okay, then I guess I'm acting.
So apart from the attention that it got you, did getting a national award also do anything for your perception of, okay, this is, I'm recognized for this work, this means something? Did it change your relationship with acting at all, that award recognition, or it was mostly external?
One has always seen very deserving candidates go unrewarded, and one has often seen awards given to people who may not seem very good. So I think that awareness was always there to a certain extent. But and my relationship with acting changed slowly over the years, because this was still my third film. So I think it was over several years that I actually started developing this kind of detachment, which was really useful to me in life and with acting also. Because initially what would happen is I would get very involved with the film set, at least mentally. As in, why is the set like this? Why is the production design been like this? Why is this character coming in right now? This doesn't seem real. This is not something she would say. You know, this looks fake. Or even just questioning many choices that the film director may have made. And then getting upset about it, which is not constructive at all. But eventually down the line, I managed to develop this kind of a healthy detachment that, you know, I have to maintain my own space and do my own work. And what I think I had to develop, and I did slowly over the years, knowingly or unknowingly, both, I think, at different times, is develop a lot of concentration, a lot of focus to be able to work on a film set, to create that space out for yourself. Because a film set is very stressful, it's chaotic, there are so many people working, and each job is very important. And to be able to, you may be doing a very emotionally disturbing scene, like in Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, you maybe have that clip. But it's just that in Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, we have that moment when, you know, it's an emotional scene. It's an emotional scene, and I'm talking about, and also the show's later. It's a very emotional scene at the end of the film, and I have this baby in my arms, and I'm saying goodbye to the man I kind of loved, who's not my husband. My husband has come to pick me up from the station. And there's this child in my arms, and there are, of course, the camera's in front of me, and there are about 10 people in front of me who are all going, hi, it's okay, come on. And you know, trying to distract the child, who's being very cranky. And I'm saying, like, the most important line, crying, saying goodbye, Mr. Iyer, when he's not really Mr. Iyer. So, you know, you have to be able to develop yourself in such a way that you are still able to do your own thing while letting other people do theirs.
So I think you've created such an moment for us. We're going to watch that scene.
Yeah. Oh my god.
So that's the real husband, you're reuniting.
Yeah, my husband is coming to pick me up from the station. And I have gone to... Just pause it 1 second. I just want to say that this is Mrs. Iyer, and she was on this journey where there were some communal riots and a lot of violence, and the passengers were all stranded together for a time, a few days, and then finally at the end of the film they're able to come back to their families. So this is just the last scene.
Good. You're out of my mind, Sudhwari. Where is Satana? Let me inside the train.
Okay.
কখন এসেছে?
আমার কিছু কাজ আছে। ওরা তো আসবে অফিসে। আমি তো জানি না লাইফ থেকে ফোন করেছে। আমি তো সঞ্জীবের কাছ থেকে খবর পেলাম। আচ্ছা কি বলছে এরা? আপনার একদম চিন্তা করবেন না।
কেন তো অফিসের কাছে যায়?
And there were a lot of stories from that time, you know, like family anecdotes. particles and animals and things like that, some of those stories were also a little creepy or a little chilling. So the film I made was kind of set in one of those, that is the context of it. I wanted to make a film about the people we overlook, about the people who are not saying, look at me, and you know, this is my problem. And about how you know, we are responsible for ourselves and for everybody else in a way. So that's why I the film is set very specifically in 1979 in McCluskeyganj, which has its own particular context, because McCluskeyganj is an Anglo-Indian colony, which also has, you know, the local Bihari people, a lot of Bengali people, and it's a very specific milieu.
Do you think we should watch
the trailer? Yeah.
Right? So this film is going to be out on June 2nd at a theater near you. And here's a preview.
Thank you.
But I would actually like to open it up and perhaps use the questions as a way to get into those other matters. So we'll open up for questions now, and I would really like the students, so you've seen a feature film of Konkona, you've heard a little bit about the journey, you've now seen a little sneak preview of the directorial debut. If there's any questions that you have. Okay. Yes.
Something I'm curious about is that, I mean, acting obviously is pretending to be someone that you're not, right? But I know that, at least in the US, one is allowed to pretend to be problematized. In particular, as it concerns race, for example, Scarlett Johansson playing, who's a white person playing an Asian woman. But even outside of this, I know there, I've heard about like Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, and some dwarf actors got mad that dwarfs were cast in that show. And so, because you mentioned that you were playing a Tamil person, and Mr. and Mrs. I thought I had to ask an actor for, about this.
Yeah.
So I was wondering what your personal view was, participated in that discourse.
You know, that's so true, because today while I was saying it, I thought the same thing. I mean, I did say that to the director, in all fairness. I said that, and I even suggested Suchitra Pillai.
Okay.
I had an actor in mind, actually, to play that particular part, and I think that that would definitely lend itself to more authenticity. Ideally, I think that that's the best way to go about it, and I think in my film I've done that as well, as much as possible. It's not always possible. I know that in terms of integrity or in terms of other aspects of that film, Mr. Kisaraya, we have stuck to really telling a very authentic and a very important story about communal relations, etc. And I know, you know, but in that particular situation, I think what happens is that there are certain advantages, because I'm a daughter and I've come at very little cost in a very low budget film as well. And she knew how I would be, you know, so it was less of a risk for her, so I can understand her motives. But I mean, ideally, I think yes, a Tamilian actress would have been ideal, and I think that's probably well cast. Like, for example, Luck by Chance, you see the casting, not the ratio so much, but the casting has been done so well. Because a lot of those actors in real life are actually, you know, like that. They're typecast in many ways, and I'm being the actress who's a bit of an outsider, and I do feel like an outsider in many ways to the industry, to the mainstream Bollywood industry. You know? So in that sense, it's very well cast. I mean, of course, acting is such a thing that one should be able to do all kinds of roles. And I think that it's a symptom of a larger problem, probably, the way they said in the US, when it is with Peter Brooks, Mahabharat, we're seeing all kinds of actors, and that, you know, is also lends itself to, you know, beautiful complexities to explore. But it is complicated because there are other racial tensions, and, you know, that's the essence of the problem.
That's great to think about historical context and things about what are the tensions and sensitivities one must have in that moment.
Like, for example, Mr. Mustay, there's a Jewish character.
Yeah.
You know, and the thing is that when I was in the US, people have been very sensitive to it. But the thing is, in India, we have no history of racial discrimination against Jewish people.
Yeah.
So it's viewed very differently here.
Yeah. Can we have some? I was wondering
if like how depictions of female characters are like changed between Hindi film and Bengali film, and whether that can be extended to like larger national discourses about female portrayal and like traditional Indian womanhood, as well as whether you think like an actress has the social responsibility to comment on politics of the time.
Over the last part of the question first, whether an actress has social responsibility to comment on politics. I don't think she must comment on social, it's not a responsibility in that sense. I don't think that she's under any obligation to comment on the political climate of the time. And it depends on who wants to listen also, because she may not be an expert on that. She may be, you know, good at certain things and may not, you know, be good at others. Though I think it's always more interesting, and it's if one is aware of the political climate, if one is aware of the trends in the industry, and then one is making informed choices, I think that's always more interesting for the actor and for the people who are watching, definitely. Female protagonists have been portrayed very differently through the years. I mean, Debbie Debashree will be able to tell you much more. But I found that in the course of making films, it's not like I've worked with also like quite a few women directors, not as many as the male directors I've worked with. But there's no guarantee that a female director will necessarily be more empathetic to women's problems. Or she can be equally chauvinistic in her attitude. Whereas Ritu Bonagosh I found particularly sensitive to gender issues, to gender problems, to giving the woman the space to kind of be her own person or make her own choices, unconventional as they may be, they cannot fit into, they cannot conform to what is expected of her. But so it has changed, it's widely varied. I mean, I've had all kinds actually.
So when you were talking about your filmmaking process, you said that you're interested in kind of highlighting and amplifying the voices of the underrepresented. And coming from a kind of tradition of like Bengali filmmaking, the first name I would think of is perhaps like Rinal Sen, who's like known as a Marxist filmmaker. So I'm just thinking if, what do you think that kind of like, do you think that kind of like legacy of like Marxist filmmaking has like influenced like your own view towards like filmmaking? And if so, like in what ways has it like shaped your own like process as a filmmaker?
You know, I've not seen any of Rinal Sen. But I think that, you know, I probably come from a place which is kind of more humanistic in its approach, not so much consciously Marxist, because I'm, what I meant by, you know, like people who are not necessarily represented as much or overlooked, is that, you know, there's a very interesting social hierarchy even within family groups, which is what I want to show. So there's obviously, actually, there's a very particular scene where I try to show that. I said, you know, there's of course the man, and then there's the wife, then there's the lover, and then last of all is this character Shubhi, who's playing the young boy in the film. Because he is, and it's not because he's the youngest that may partly be something have something to do with it, but it's also because he's not behaving like a man. He's not behaving like what we expect, men here in India or men to behave and what we allow them to get away with. Like the alpha male in this film, when we show his character Vikram, is allowed to get away with many more things under the guise of boys and boys, which is the line in the film. But because this boy doesn't behave like that and is fired, he's automatically not given that space. So if the question is just to, if the mindset is such that to give space to who are not necessarily clamoring for it. It's great if you're asking for your space and you have got the space, that's great in itself as well. But I think to generally be compassionate and empathetic in your worldview, Andy would actually solve a lot of problems.
And it'll be fun if we can go watch the film together, because there's just so many issues that Konkona raises in it. From the question of the Anglo-Indian community,
yeah,
their history, their legacy, questions of masculinity, femininity within the family.
The Anglo-Indian community, I just want to add, the Anglo-Indian community is actually, you know, where one parent is British and one parent is Indian, because British ruled over us for so many years, and they traditionally have not found a space or really felt a sense of belonging, usually most of them, in India. And they founded this place, E.T. McCluskey founded this place, McCluskey Gun, which that's where it's called, the place of McCluskey, in 1933. But in 1947 we had independence from Britain, and a lot of the Anglo-Indians left. So in a way, for me, it's like the way that the Anglo-Indians felt removed from the homeland.
Mm-hmm.
In a similar way, I feel that this protagonist, Shuntu, is also distanced from the rest of his community, the rest of his family, who kind of all play towards his, well, downfall, so to speak, without really revealing too much. I really hope you will watch the film. It pleases a fine into the second.
And it's interesting the way you're describing it, because thinking about in-betweenness, right? So someone who is not fully the macho alpha male, but is a man who also has heterosexual desires in this film, right? Being half Indian, half British, and also us thinking today about the insiders and the outsiders in the film industry, thinking about Luck by Chance. And you suggesting that you, when you were cast in Luck by Chance, you did feel like you were an outsider in the Bombay film industry.
Absolutely, and I think that's why it's cast so well, and I still feel like an outsider with the industry. And I think that's great. I'm totally comfortable with that. No, I'm totally comfortable with that, because it gives me a certain distance. It gives me objectivity, you know, to see things. I mean, I don't know what those conclusions are yet.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm
address questions that are of interest and are vital.
Or things you want to bring up which,
yeah,
which are not being addressed.
Exactly.
Which are trying to do in this film, because, yeah, I don't think that we'll be looking at things like this. Because we're, you know, we're mainly firstly looking at women.
Yeah.
Through me and Zaka.
Which is very interesting because the main protagonist is a young man.
Yeah, and I was asked about that,
yeah,
as well, that how come the protagonist is a man?
Yeah.
And, I have to say that I have no good answer for that.
Yeah.
I feel that it should not be incumbent upon me to have to make a film about a woman, and maybe I will eventually. I need to be given that space to make the film that I want to make.
Yeah.
And raise the issues that I want to raise, and it's so much about masculinity, and that itself is so much about gender.
No, so I clearly we're getting a sense of how the mode in which one chooses to make that social comment or depends really on the ways in which one feels most equipped, most able, has the platform, and we all will find our own ways to do that. We might have time for one last question. Someone has a pressing question. Okay, Ambo.
So in class today, we were discussing a lot about like how the personal lives of film actresses have often been subject to like a huge amount of public scrutiny and curiosity. So I was wondering how your relationship with the public and the media have changed as you've made the transition from acting to directing.
I've only just directed my first film. It's yet to release. So in that sense, there's not been a huge shift, or at least I'm slowly going to see the effects of that now as I do more and more media interaction and see how that pans out. But there has been a lot of interest in my personal life as well. Luckily, I'm not one of those really big celebrities who can't walk on the street at all, you know, who's hounded all the time. So I have been, I would say lucky in that sense, because I'm able to experience life very differently. I can see sometimes things from both sides. But having said that, early on I was asked many questions about my relationships, my marriage, my son, my separation from my husband and all of that. But I think that you don't always have to participate in what's going around culturally. You don't have to. If you think it's not okay, you don't have to. Like, I'm often asked for selfies and often I will say no. Because I know that it seems rude and it seems like I'm not being a nice person. But the thing is, I don't want to participate in that. It's only when I'm dressed and at an event or at work that I will actually do selfies, but not in my regular life. And in the same way, I've always said to journalists that I'm not going to speak about my personal life. It served me really well. And now I think they've just given up. And I actually got married after I got pregnant.